Right. Top at gate. That's right. Today's topic is going to be making a gate that is switchable or enableable, whatever, crossable. It's like a key. Basically, you know, there's going to be a certain area of the overworld where you have to have the top hat to be able to pass beyond that area. Let me run this and see. Let's get a screenshot. Yeah, openable. Exactly. Yeah. So wait, what gate is it? Let's take a picture of that. Start running the game instead of seeing the overworld scene. And here, we're going to warp the player to the gate, which is the top hat gate. I forget which one of these is the top hat gate. Let's look at the constants for that. Oh, nice. Let me check this out. Can I do this on a... Oh, yeah, cool. I can do this on the iPad. Oh, that's beautiful, man. Wow. Is that supposed to be a certain, like, molecule or something? It looks really cool. Nice reflection. Diffuse glow. Shadows. Cast shadows. Dude. That's nice. Man. That's awesome, dude. How long did it take to do that? What's up, Arcane? So, okay, the second gate is the top hat gate. What's up, Arcane? Sorry, I just said that. Man, it's cold today. Okay, the one thing, though, I need to make sure these are the right gates being applied. So, I think there's a function called hasGate. Wow. That's pretty fast, man. I know you've done this before, so that's probably why, huh? Oh, this is not even using these. What's up, Pure Demon? I'm working on the top hat gate. So, this will be a gate. Like, check us out. This is what the overworld is like for this current world seed. The overworld generator is a lot better now. It does a lot of stuff to make sure these worlds are really cool. Especially, like, putting in gates. And so, you can see that this is properly, like, blocked off. You can't cross these boundaries. Except at... when you've got a gate. So for example, all this yellow line I just drew is where the player can't cross. You can't cross from one area type to another or one section to another unless you're at a gate. And to get across a gate, you need a certain item. So I'm working on the item to allow you to cross a gate with the top hat. So you're gonna be able to throw your top hat, hit a switch, and that switch will open the gate. Ah, nice. Acceleration structure. Cool. Wow, what's the basic... How do you do that? How do you make your renderer just, like, a lot faster like that? Okay, so now I'm verifying that where this code is, that it processes the gate types. Oh, yeah, so K flag gate is what I need to look for. Nice, man. Yeah, so that's what I'm working on today. I'll be doing a little pixel art to make the switch look cool, but I'll mostly be working on behavior at first. So just getting purely the behavior of throwing the top hat, hitting the switch, opening up the gate. Is it there? World.cpp? Oh, yeah, here it is. This is where it creates doors. Okay, so it's looking at... Okay, so the key conditions here are being applied just fine. No, this is C++. Yeah, so this is where it pushes back the key condition. It probably would be good to give it a function for this. Maze.get, like get gate type. Yeah, let's make a function called get gate type. That's gonna be, it's gonna return a gate type. And X, Y, yeah, that's all we need there. Get gate type. So we'll apply this function here in maze, has gate, set gate, get style. And this is the number of the gate right here. And it's just good to put this same code for setting the gate, right? Here's where I'm checking if it has a gate. Here's where I'm setting a gate. And here's where I'm getting a gate type. All right here in the same place. So that's really the point of just doing that. So I don't have to hunt around the code anymore. This does mean that we're going to need I guess we could static cast a -1 to be a gate type on error. And then this will be rich return. And this needs to be this get flags for X, Y. Shift them down 32 bits. I could add a direction to this, but I don't think that's going to be necessary. Reflection, refraction, anti-aliasing, hard shadows, soft shadows. Ooh, yeah. Depth of field. Wow, nice. You're gaming on a game? Nice, man. Oh, working on a game. Right on. Cool, dude. What are you using for your AI? What's up, Letter Thief? Yeah, Top Hat Gate. What did you miss? Well, I've really only been working on this the past few days. This is actually pretty neat, though. This is what the overworld looks like now. And these GN areas, all these, this is gate north. These are gates, basically. So basically, all these yellow areas right here, these yellow lines are areas where the player can never cross. The maze never allows movement in that direction, so... Like all of this, you can never cross this, but you can cross at a gate. So gates are just basically things that, you know, block the player until you have a certain item. So today I'm working on the top hat gate, and that will just be something where you throw your top hat, it hits a switch, and then opens up the gate. Yeah. So this is going to make the overworld way more interesting to play. And also it will naturally sort of act kind of like a tutorial process almost, where the player is kind of kept within certain bounds until they've acquired certain items or have figured out some other way to get around those gates if they don't have the items. For example, there is one gate, the first one, the gate type one, which is this one, is the sword gate. But this one can also be opened with bombs. So it's just a simple thing where it's the growback tiles, and the growback tiles can also be hurt with bombs. So if you wanted to, you could play the entire game without getting the sword. Yeah, the redness of the path is indirectly the difficulty of mobs. Really, it's just the distance from the start point. So the start point's here for this maze. And white would indicate that it's really close to the start point, and red indicates that it's really far from the start point, given the distance you have to walk to get there. So if I were to walk to, like, right there, I'd have to walk all the way over here. You know what I mean? This gets to be a long, long walk just to get to that point or whatever. Oh, nice. Oh, cool. Thanks, Pedro. Let me check that out. Itch.io community. All right. Yeah, if I can work that into my marketing schedule, I'll do that. Yeah, thanks, man. How are you doing? How's everything going? Okay, I don't need to check for the direction in this method. I'm just going to go ahead and return. Actually, we just go, if num is greater than 0, return num shifted down 3 plus 1. And otherwise, oh, this needs to be static cast as well. There we go. So now that's going to return a gate type. I'm thinking maybe I should actually put gate type none. Nice, you're resting a little bit. Cool. Painting and pixeling. Ah, oh, the life. It's the life, man. I'm considering putting it 0 as a gate type that'll be invalid. I guess that would be okay. Thanks, Pure Demon. Appreciate that, man. But is it necessary to do right now? Not really. I guess it kind of is. This whole static cast gate type negative one is kind of janky. All right. Anyway, let's do this. I'm going to add a constant that's an invalid gate type. Or none. Yeah, so that'll be 0. And then knum gate types is just going to be kgate 8. All right, so rebuild all that. I think there's a place where I use kgate. Oh, oops. Kgate 1. I know I use this in the maze generator at some point. So yeah, this will work, right? Gate section, K gate one. Oh wait, let's see. This might not be. Where does it use these? This gets passed into choose gates, possible gates, number of gates, gate types. Here we go. That's in place gates. Uses the gate types. Oh, that calls set gate, gate type G. I think this needs to be plus four, maybe minus one. Or minus, okay, gate one. Let me check that though. And we need to turn back on overworld scene, check this. It's 1 point nice, dude. Did you get it? What's up, Mike? You just won. Bam. Hype. Mike won too. Nice. That's what he says. Insert seam key here. Cool. That's pretty awesome. Oh, I forgot about that. What's up, Felix? What Mac am I using? I'm using a MacBook Pro 2013 model with Retina. It's awesome. I love it. Best computer I've had. But I would love to have a better computer, and I also love to have multiple displays. That would be super awesome. One of my development dreams. Okay, so let's see what kind of gate. This is the first gate, gate one. Flag number is already four, which is one shifted up the direction, which is the direction is two. Right. Now let's take a look at flag number as a binary. So yeah, that's zero. This would be south, west, north, east. And then this is the first bit for the first gate. So we should be seeing this bit turn on. So that should be 10100 after that. Yeah. Nice, 10100. Cool, and then shift all that up. Set it. Yeah, that's cool. Why did I change the game to creative? I was just experimenting with that new creative category where you can, the benefit to the creative category is that you can specify hashtags. But I get this. I get asked this question so much that I'm considering going back to just calling it game development. So what do you think? Should I do that? Yeah, totally. Weekly contest. Oh, no, that's cool. Yeah. Where it's a contest kind of based on creativity. I like that. Ah. This is gate two. We've got a flag. Oh, 0, 1, 2, 3, 2, 2. Yeah, these are correct. Well, now we need to also get the gate type correctly. Right. What's up, PMC? All right, so that was correct, doing plus four minus gate one. And here's where we get gate type. This needs to be a little different. So we're getting the flags, and there's really no need to do if number is greater than one or zero anymore, because zero is a valid gate type. So num shifted down three plus one. And now we need to use this whole get gate type method in, where was that? Was it in world? Yeah, it was world. No, it wasn't world. Where was that? FPS? What are you talking about? Yeah. How long did it take you to learn programming in C++? A couple years. Yeah, a couple years, my man. I started with C, actually. I would highly recommend that if you're wanting to learn C++, just start with C. It's a little more simple. You're going to get the concept of pointers and all the basics of C first. And then it's a really, once you understand C, it's like the building blocks of C++. It's much easier to understand C++ and some of its higher level concepts once you understand the lower level concepts in C. Yeah, you would. It's there in world. All right, yeah, so it was world. So now we need to get, basically, key condition equals maze.get gate type for p.x, p.y. And we need to make sure this works. So I'm going to set a breakpoint there. So I am about to run the game pretty soon. I'm just working on some foundational code here for the gates. And then I'll be working on the behavior of a top hat gate. All right, so key condition, right. What position is this again? This is 100. First of all, let's see. Wait, I've already got this opened up in Photoshop. So 100, yeah, that's this first area. This should be a gate to the west, and it should be the gate number 1 or a key condition 1. So let's see what happens there. All right, so I've got, yeah, position still 100. Step over this method. We've got a key condition. Should be 1. But we got 3. That turned out wrong. Okay, I'm going to start over. Awesome. Oh, right on. Cool, man. Sounds like you got a good foundation for it. All right, so what does num come out to be? 18. Let's see that in binary. This should be south. That should be west, which it is. This would be north, south. This is the first gate. Oh, this needs to be minus, I think. So num shifted down 3 would be this. Shifted down 1, 2, 3. Okay, I'm seeing this 4 plus g minus gate is a more right there. And this needs to be num shifted down 4. That's it. Just num shifted down 4. Right? So if I had this same number, it would be 1 shifted down 1, 2, 3, 4. Let's run that again. Oh, I'm happy I could do some basic bit shifting math today. Sometimes my brain's just not in the zone, but today it's enough in the zone where this is seeming pretty easy. Key condition, get gate type. X and Y should be 1, 0. What's this number for the flags? Same thing, good. Return the static cast of that, shifted down 4. We should have 1 as the return value. It didn't give us a return value. It's kind of lame. Because I did. Let's see what key condition turned out to be. All right, 1. Good. Yay. Rocket Bunny. What's up, man? Welcome to today's stream. Yes. You're a winner, dude. Total winner. Twice in one stream. Killed it. For sure. Okay, I'm happy with this. I've now abstracted away the method for getting a gate type from the maze. So, very cool. What? Yeah, right on. All right, we're ready to do this. Wait, there's one more thing. That was the salt. The salt value was off on the world. Salt. Unsigned salt. Oh, there it is. So we'll say salt is zero, and then, well, or if, yeah, if world.retry count is greater than zero, then salt equals world retry count shifted up one minus one, and that produces an odd value or zero. So salt is either zero or an odd value. And that is going to change the world. So I need to recheck it out. Let's make sure. Yeah, we've got an overworld scene going still. Sell your computer. Oh, an in-game scandal? That could, right. Look at that. I think it gave the same world. First of all, let's make sure this salt turned out to be zero. Yeah, world creation succeed with salt one. Oh, that explains it. So yeah, it took one retry. That's why the first world didn't matter. So it took this seed, added zero, failed because of this one case here. The next case it succeeds on. Okay, that's good. In fact, this is good enough. This is a very small check-in, but I'm going to check in anyways because that's some fundamental stuff here that's done. I kind of want to set it in stone by committing it to the repo. Okay. All right, we're ready to do this now. So where is this at? Here's gate one. That one should be the growback tiles. We can confirm that. You got your chocolate milk? Nice. What? Okay, wait. Where's... I guess we can just confirm the first gate type. So put the player at 1-0. This didn't work. Oh, it did work. They're just hidden. They're completely hidden. Wow. it over here. Wow, it did. That's something to clear up. There's a method in area patterns. I think it's called bushes to trees. Yeah, here it is. And if I return from that, this method, I think it won't put any. All right, man. Good night, Ladder Thief. Oh yeah, okay, so that was totally it. That method is completely responsible for placing trees. So let's put a check in there where it's not going to transform. It's not going to transform a tree or a bush into a tree if there's any kind of gate tile to the north of it. So that would be this. Instead of doing get tile, I could do is tile x, y. I believe there's an is tile method that takes a vector. Yeah, it does. Right there. And so I can put a vector of tile types to look for. And I'm looking for k tile 9, k tile grow back, etc. Oh, that did not work. What if it's like that? I mean, this is supposed to be not. Huh, I totally broke this. I thought that was supposed to, that would have worked. Oh, no, I think this did work. I just forgot to comment that out. There, yeah, cool, it worked. All right, so what it's doing there is it's making sure that it doesn't place any trees right below grow back tiles. So at least you can see them now. And I don't know why it's putting these grow back tiles on both sides. There shouldn't be these on both sides. I don't think there should be. Okay, so where does it place those grow back tiles? There's pattern home. We don't necessarily need these anymore right there. I guess we could keep them though. It's not hurting anything. Pattern entrance. Oh, this puts the grow back tiles around an entrance. That tests some gates. Oh, here we go, gates. I'm tempted. Bubba is online, ready to rock. I'm tempted to rename these instead of it being K-Tal Growback and Bombable Pillar. Would be Gate 1, Gate 2. Yeah, I think that's probably smarter. That's awesome. Oh, yeah, Windows. Isn't that weird? Sometimes it does that? The EXEs? Alright, so replace all these. KTAL Gate 1. The Bombable Pillar, I think, is K-Tal Gate 3, is that right? Yeah, Gate 3. And we might as well put in all the other gate types while we're at this. 4. And right here, when we're doing this whole add gates, we can do all these different gate types. Actually, we need area.h. We need to be able to create all these, like the grow bag tile, bombable pillar. This is now gate 1, gate 2, gate 3. Boogie 1! What's up, Rage Paint? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Okay. I think that's good to compile now. Gate. K-Tal type gates. Oh, tile index, this is wrong. No wonder. This tile index is actually now door.keyCondition. Nice. You already got your Black Friday gifts? Sweet. Or door dot key condition is greater than k num gate types. Yeah, you know, gate types. And we don't need number of gates. So auto tile is k tile gate 1 plus tile index, which could just be door key condition minus 1. And all this needs to be static cast to a tile type. Rocket Bunny won. We got a lot of winners today. Right, here's where we got, instead of grow back tile, this is now gate one tile. This and the bombable pillar should be at the very end. I'll preface these with a little gates type thing. This is the grow back tile. The bombable pillar. This is a gate one or gate three tile. Now we need some dummy methods for the rest of them. What's up, Zanger? Tile sets in Unity 2D. Wish I could help you there. Gate 2, this is the top hat gate. Getting close to having this implemented finally. Top hat gate, what are the other gates? Tile gate. All right, we got sword bomb, top hat bomb, go sword, charge attack, dash, shield, cactus. All those are question marks though, so I'm not gonna worry about naming those for now. Let's do gate 4. Kind of empty. Oh, importing, huh? Wish I could help you with that. I've never done it. Gate 2 tile, this is the top hat gate. Gate 3, bombable pillar. Gate 4, this is an empty, unknown. 5, 6, 7, 8. All right, so I'm gonna run it and make sure everything's still hunky-dory. And then I'm gonna figure out why it's got two different growback tiles on one screen. Typically a gate should only be in one direction, and in this case the direction is to the west, but it's putting a gate to the east and the west on the screen. This is the Y, so I want to fix that. So it does look like everything is all good with it creating these in general. So I guess the next thing to figure out is why this has the eastward facing tiles right there. And that was in area patterns where it was creating or adding gates. This is the method. Oh, look at that. We don't even need this anymore. All right. Oh, it does need to check the direction. Oh, wait, it does get the door. This get door. All right, I'll set a breakpoint. I guess we need to check this. So if this area is V3I100, then we're gonna break. Yeah, I know they're stuck, right? I just ripped my pants. Yeah. What do we got here? What do we got here? Add gates. We should be at the right area. Let's look at this thing. This area, it should have an array of doors. It's got two doors. Oh, well, there's the issue. It's already got two doors. They both have a key condition. Oh. Well, that's easy enough. So it's in world.cpp. When it's setting the gate, it gives a key condition, but this shouldn't be that like that. It should be like this. If maze.hasGate in the direction. So we're talking about hasGate p.x. P.y direction D. And in fact, I think hasGate also checks for the flag gate. Yeah, it does. So we can just get rid of that. And now we should only have two doors in this area. You had the most American dinner in the world, huh? What's that? All right, so we're back, same area. Let's make sure it's only got, okay, good. Now it's got two doors, technically, because there's two areas you can walk off the screen on this area. But only one of them has a key condition of one. So now this should be fixed. We should only have one side of the screen blocked off by this gate now. Burgers and fries, oh, totally, all American. Burgers, fries, and you gotta get a milkshake. Milkshake's a pretty important part of that. Hey, look at that. Now the fans aren't stuck anymore either. Dude, that one guy right there is a total rebel. I love when they circle around each other. Great, okay, we fixed the bugs with this, confirmed everything, got all the gates organized and stuff. So let's move on to the next gate. And a hot dog and a bun, yeah. You don't necessarily need to have the hot dog to complete your all-American meal, but it definitely gives you, I think it's extra credit points. Yeah, dude, they were swinging. Totally, he's a rebel. Rebel Fant. Rebel Fant. I feel like there's a good pun in there somewhere. All right, so here's the gate we're looking at now. That's this is 15, 14, 13, 2. Let's check out 13, 2. And at first it should be nothing because we don't have anything defined for the top hat gates. Yeah, and we've got nothing to find, so nothing is being showed up here. So there should be a gate right here, though. Going from here into there. We can confirm that pretty easily, too. More chocolate milk. So instead of creating a gate 2 tile, we can just do this. Create gate 1 tile, and that would do the same thing as the grow back tiles. And this is great to have all this organized and finally be implementing the in the game stuff rather than the overworld. Overworld's freaking, you know, it's really amazing stuff to be doing and stuff like that, but it's not very visual. I can't really show you guys what the heck's going on. So it's nice to be getting some stuff that's really concrete. Some code that would make it so enemies can't start behind a gate. Right now it is kind of weird that some of these enemies are popping in on the screen from beyond the gate. Cool. And if I were to change that to create a gate 3 tile, this would now be bombable pillars. In fact, that should probably be the default. All these gate 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 for now. Those should be bombable pillars, the highest gate type we have. So this is the bombable pillar right here. You have to set a bomb. Yeah, let's make that the default. Take away that. So now anywhere else we go in the world with the gate, it should be doing some bombable pillars. And we can confirm that. Let's confirm that really quick. Let's go to like here's the highest gate we have. It's at 7, 6. Right, yeah. I need to add some really mean enemies like that. Oh, did that not work? Or am I in the wrong area? Yeah, that should definitely be a gate. We should have something right here. Okay, this is a good thing to check. Why did that not work? Where was I just a second ago? Where was, adding gates, area pattern. Now if area is 7, 6, break, check out the doors. Anything with lots of drool, totally. Guard dogs, some old dude. What was the first enemy in Songbringer? The blob. Yeah, the blob was the first enemy. And then a close second was the Dropth guy with the goat head. Yeah, the blob was really easy. I was like, ah, I gotta do a blob. It's obligatory. It's the easiest enemy to implement. Oh, by the way, check it out. I got a Songbringer shirt I'm wearing today. It's for the December 11th event. And also, I got stickers. Got some swag. So there's some stickers that I got printed up. So I'm going to hand these out at the December 11th event, Indy Cup. It's kind of a cool feeling to be a developer of a game and actually have like some physical stuff about the game. The poster was the first, you know, part of all that. And now we got stickers and shirts. No way. Totally. Legit swag. Yeah, man, right? Yeah, so there's another little incentive for anybody to come to Indy Cup in San Francisco on December 10th. Get some free stickers. You get to play the game in person. Too bad I only got two shirts. These are kind of expensive. So I can't really give these away for free with my current budget. But yeah. Free stickers. You want Jib plushies? Nice. Cool. Well, hey, that's cool. Those are easy. You know, stickers are easy. I can get them printed pretty cheap and mailed pretty cheap, too. Rocket Bunny, that's your third win of the day. It must be the chocolate milky drink. It gives you superpowers to get whatever kind of reward you want. Key condition 128. That's the problem. What's the next thing? Key condition 00 and 128. This is the west, right? 66. Yeah, that's the west. Yeah, so there's our problem. It did a totally the wrong key condition. It's just because you're lucky. Chocolate milk gives you plus one luck. Where was that again? World? Okay, this is where we need to pay attention. What is this P? I think it's P. Yeah, P is a position we're checking. If P is 760, break, then we can check out what happens there. Why does it produce gate number 128? It's like, oh. It might need to be shifted down or something. What's up, Game Vivo? So we have a gate. No, not in this current direction. What's the next direction? This should be probably west. D west. Yeah, west. This is the direction we need to look at anyways. Destination position. Add direction. Destination should be 660. 660. And yeah, it's probably just boils down to this get gate type. If we have a gate, we do. Good. Then set the condition to the gate type that we're getting. There's our number. This is pointing to, this would be south, this is west, this is north and east. Okay, so then we have So these bits need to be not only, we need to get the bit number from this, not just the shifted down four. I'm making new gates, that keep the player within a certain area until they have a certain item. For example, you might need the sword to cross over some bramble bushes or something like that. You might need some bombs to get rid of some bombable pillars. And this is the gate type I'm working on right now is the top hat gate, where you'll have to throw your top hat, hit some switch, that opens up a gate. Also, clearly, all this needs to do is, once we shift down 4 to get the bits, and then we need to know the bit number. That would be get flag number. I already have a method that does that. It's get flag number. So let's fix this. Where'd that go? Get the gate type. Right. So num. I guess this just could be 36. Or just num shifted down equals 4 again. And then we get the flag number. I think this could just be get flag number from num. Is that right? Get flag number. Nope. Yeah, let's just do our, we need to do our own method for that. Thanks, man. No, this is not always how games implement this solution. This is kind of a unique game in that every one of the tiles in the entire game is procedurally generated. This is a very zoomed out view of it all. Every single one of these areas, like that area right there, for example, has, you know, hundreds of tiles within it. And every one of the tiles in the game is procedurally generated. So a lot of games, what they do to implement this kind of thing, like a gate, for example, is they use preset patterns. So they have, you know, a bunch of different preset areas they've already prefabricated, and then they're randomly arranged. So that is procedurally generating. It's just randomly arranging. So I don't know. I think this game is a little bit purer in how it procedurally generates, because it's going all the way down to the tile level. So it's a little bit different. So yeah, not all games do it this way, basically. Sorry to belabor that point. So we'll do for I is less than 0 or less than k num gate types. If num and 1 shifted up I, then return I. You know, that's gonna be return static cast gate type. I plus 1, otherwise return k gate none. Yes, you may. I'm 35 years old. I'm almost 36. I'll be 36 next month. No, this month. This is December already. I'm going to be turning... I'm 8. I'm 8 years old. Yep, I was lying about being 36. I'm actually 8. Okay, so this first one is no door. Next one, we're getting the condition. Check it. Let's check it. Get the gate type. Number, shift it down 32. Shift it down 4. Again, we've got, this should be gate numbers. This would be gate number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Yeah. That should be our maximum gate number. So we're going to loop through. Time does fly. It sure does. Should be all the way to I number 7. Here we go. If num and 1 shifted up 7. Yeah, return static cast I plus 1. Yeah, all right, now we've got accurate gate numbers. It's a good thing I checked that. It was a good thing to check. So key condition should be 8. Great. We're straight. We're straight, man, it said 8. That's great. All right, so run it again, and now we should have bombable pillars as the tiles. You don't even know how November passed? Who does? All right, it worked. Yeah, so once the other gate types are in there, this will be, you know, this will no longer be just a bomb of pillar. This will be the eighth gate type or whatever that is. So, all right, we're ready to move back to here, 13.2. Does it ever get cold in Cali? Yes, it does. 8 Celsius in Amsterdam. Wow, that's like, I think that's like 40. High 40s. Oh yeah, so this is because this should be a gate right here, but that's for the top hat gate. So we need, right? Is that correct? Did not do the. Yeah, it does get cold in Cali. Actually, not as much in Southern California. Southern California, it's almost always like 60 or 70 degrees, which is your 20 to 30 degrees. Dude, pretty soon Papu is going to be able to do everything. Yeah, 48. Yeah. Yo, what's up, Xbox Taco? Yeah, yeah. So, yeah, it does get pretty cold. It does get pretty cold here, at least in Northern Cal. You know, it's the same kind of thing. We get to around, like, 48 or 40s. Which is your low single digits Celsius, but not that much colder. And usually it's a little warmer than that. Whoa, yeah, it's cold everywhere in the Northern Hemisphere, it seems right now, huh? Right. Okay, we're ready. We're ready to finally do this. So now we need to put in two things. This is kind of a complex gate. There needs to be two things. There needs to be a row of tiles right here that prevents the player from walking across. I don't know what those are going to be. Maybe just a row of like blocks or something like that that are sticking up for now, and then when you hit the switch they just lower into the earth. Or it could be water. It could be water right here, and when you hit the switch the water dries up. Either way, we need to implement two things. We need the switch like about right here, and then we need a bunch of tiles right here to make it so that we can throw the top hat and just barely hit it. So I'm thinking like 4 to 5 different tiles. Let's see, how far can we throw the top hat north and south? Okay. Right, yeah, Sierra Nevada's totally. Yeah. Probably gets colder than that up there, huh? Number 7, do I have any future plans to do marketing for Songbringer? Yeah, of course. I do marketing every day, and I have plans to market Songbringer all the way through to its completion and beyond that. We almost need a special area type for these bombable pillars. Or I guess we could just put it in the get in the add gate type. Okay, I think for now I'm just gonna I'm not gonna do the art just yet. I'm gonna do the behavior first. So I'm gonna do all the programming for these tiles before I ever do the art. And what I'm gonna start with is I'm gonna start with just the bombable pillar tiles that I already have. And but these are gonna be special bombable pillar types that require a switch to be hit before they open up or destroyed or whatever. So it would be kind of like this. Got the bombable pillar type. Porcupines. Yeah. Oh man, I would love to have some retreat land up there in the Sierras sometime someday. It's one of my dreams. I love it up there. It's one of my favorite places. How do you measure when marketing was successful? Member seven, that's a great question. It's a great question. Well, how do you measure the success of marketing? First of all, you've got to recognize that the success that you can perceive in your marketing efforts is really only the tip of the iceberg. It's very much like that with marketing. You only really see, like, for example, I would measure it like this with measuring how much of a following you have based on how many followers you have on Twitter, how many followers you got on, or likes you got on Facebook. You add up all those numbers, and that's kind of a rough indicator of the tip of the iceberg of your following for a game. So, for example, if you had a combined amount of like 1,000 followers combined on Twitter, Facebook, and all that, all those different social networks and stuff like that, you might really have more like 10,000 followers of the game. And so, that's it. That's how I would measure success with marketing is how big is your following. And of course you can measure success in other ways, but that's kind of one simple way you could do it. And also just remember to recognize that it's not always what you see is not always the total. It's all often much bigger than what you can see. Yeah. Okay, so now if we have a now let's to create a bombable pillar type, but what I wanted this to behave a little bit differently. I don't want it to be able to be destroyed by a bomb. I just want it to be able to be disabled by a switch. So okay, we've got enough. That's good to start with this art right here. But let's do that so we can to make this entity type. Yeah, here we go. We need to create another entity type. This is going to be, we'll just call this the switchable pillar. For now, it'll just be, yeah, pillar three, rock type, static, but no damage mask bomb. So these are not going to be able to be destroyed by the bomb. And then create gate two tile. This will be now switchable pillar. Yeah, you're welcome, member seven. What exactly is a null pointer? Do you have to understand what a pointer is? Do you understand what a pointer is, first of all? A pointer is just all a pointer is the address in memory of another variable. For example, you might have a variable called x, and that might be an integer variable, which is 4 bytes long, and or 4 bytes on whatever platform. Let's say it's just whatever platform you're on is 4 bytes. So to take the address of that x variable, you now have a pointer, and that pointer points to this is the memory address. All pointers are just memory addresses. So a null pointer is simply just the memory address 0. Null is 0. Null pointer is just the memory address 0, and that's invalid. You're gonna get an access error if you try and dereference a null pointer, which means to follow that memory address. If you try and follow the memory address 0, you're gonna get an error, bad access. Is math important in computer science? Of course it is. Yes. Wholeheartedly yes. So, I should not be able to bomb those now? Great. These now need to be sort of disabled some other way. So there's one more component to this. We need to be able to put a switch on the other side of that wall. So on the other side of this wall, we're going to put a switch tile that disables gate type 2. So right over where these blue blobs are right now, there needs to be a switch. Which means we need a different kind of tile type, possibly. How come Bill Gates says that math is not important in computer science? Can you show me where he says that? I really can't see why he would ever say that. What's up, Spymort? Yeah, please show us a quote for that. Okay. Well, we need a tile type, we need to place that tile, and then we need to be able to kind of get it working where its behavior is that you can hit it with the top hat and it switches off the other tiles. So starting with the tile type, ask Bill Gates. Bill Gates, we need a quote. I think there's already like a switch. Statue refill sphere level. Nope, there is no just general switch tile. Okay. Well, I'm trying to decide whether this switch tile should have some kind of like extra bit of information somehow that says, okay, this is a switch tile that disables the top hat pillars or whatever. I don't know. I'm just going to call it gate tile, gate 2 switch for now. So we'll have a separate tile type for gate 2. Maybe the other gates have, you know, switches as well. But for now, we'll just do that. So it specifically works on gate 2 switches or gate 2 tiles. Oh, we need one more thing. We need an area.h. We need the ability to create a gate 2 tile switch or gate 2 switch tile. Yeah. area.cpp. Need to hook this up. Area creation. We need this little method here. Creates a gate to switch. Okay, we've got a tile type now. I guess we need to be able to create it. It'd be nice, yeah. So let's create a some sort of data representing this switchable pillar. Switchable pillar switch. This is funny. Switchable pillar switch. Let's just call this the top hat gate. And let's call this the top hat switch. Yeah, we need an image for it. Let's just grab some random image for now. Maybe the cinder block. The wild cinder block. What the heck were those? Wild cinder block image. Is it called default foe or something like that? Foes. Default foe. Oh, that's what it was. There we go. There. We're going to use the wild cinder block for this. Okay, so the top hat gate switch. This is going to be default foe. Color. Let's do color red. Oops. Color FF000. Collision static. Yeah. Top hat switch. There. And back in the code, this needs to be entities. Top hat gate. Top hat switch. And we haven't placed any of these gate two switch tiles yet. So there shouldn't be anything regarding the switch yet, but we should be ready for it. So we still this should not, I shouldn't be able to cross these. I shouldn't be able to destroy them with the bombs. Cool. Okay, so now we need to place the switch in add gates. This might as well be where we're gonna put it. Add gates. Man, I love the quick open. Do you have an Xbox? No, I don't right now. Actually, I play mostly what I play are either Steam games I play on my laptop right now, or I play old school games with an emulator. So it's pretty much where I am right now in life with my gaming. But I would love to have an Xbox for if I can get this game on consoles. I would love to have an Xbox and a PlayStation 4, especially a PlayStation 4, because PlayStation's been way more friendly with indies than Xbox has. Xbox has been pretty friendly with indies with their latest Xbox One, but PlayStation has just been by far more friendly, especially their clauses. Like Xbox has this clause where you can you cannot publish on Xbox if you've already published on another console, which is, it's called the parity clause, and it's kind of ridiculous. Anything that restricts an indie game developer is going to be kind of, in my opinion, I think it's going to be bad for your platform. And I think hopefully Microsoft learned that with the Xbox One. And hopefully they bring back their Xbox Live Arcade style of indie gaming, rather than their Xbox, whatever, ID at Xbox thing they got now. Yeah, it is kind of dumb, right? I don't know what. It's so crazy to me that companies these days, we're already in the 2010s. You know, we're not in the 90s anymore. You can't do things that restrict the people that are going to help, they're going to help you sell your console, you know? And rant. So, when we're placing this gate, we need to do one more thing for this. When we place a certain gate type, we might need to place a switch. Yeah. It's not that Xbox sucks. It's just that their current legal mumbo jumbo is not very permissive for indies. But yeah, so what was the 90s like? It was the best. Yeah, watch Portlandia a little bit and you'll understand. But no, the 90s, this was kind of like right when the internet was coming out, Rocket Bunny. So no, Xbox sucks. So when before the internet, what life was like? We didn't have cell phones. We didn't have instantaneous communication. There was no way that a single individual could just be heard by everyone on the planet, right? Right now, you and I, everyone else has the ability, the power, the opportunity to create something, and it has the potential for every other being on the entire planet. Billions of people could possibly be perceiving your creation or playing your creation or looking at your art or reading this, something you wrote on a blog post or something like that. You know, it's really empowering. And what that's done for our society is many, many things, man. Like it's enabled us to be aware of what's going on the other sides of the planet. For example, back in the 90s, if something happened in China that was horrible, some tragic accident or whatever, we would probably hear about it on our news, which is a broadcasting system. But let's say that news or whatever was trying to be concealed and they were trying to cover up something like that. It was a lot easier in the 90s for people to cover stuff up. Today, with the power of the internet and people's ability to share stuff, it's a lot harder to cover up things. And so that creates sort of, because it's harder for cover-ups, it sort of paves the way for more genuine communication, whereby, you know, people kind of have to, companies, for example, have to kind of be a little more honest about things. Because if they're not honest about what they're creating or what they're doing or what they're sharing or whatever, then they're pretty much, in today's day and age, they're going to be found out. Like the whole Enron thing in America, which was last decade. You were alive for that. Enron, that's a good example, right? The internet's changed everything. And that's just one side of it. As far as games go, it's changed everything. Back in the 90s, you had to create a game, and your game had to be perfect the second you released it. So people would spend years perfecting their games before they released them, so that there would be no bugs when people played it. Like McDonald's, yeah, good example. Really? The parody clause was dismissed? Wow. Oh, well, that's cool. Yeah, totally. These are examples. And yeah, that didn't really have anything to do that much to do with games, but the last part of what I was saying I was trying to had to do with games. You know, things were a lot different back then as far as what you how you shared your games with the world and stuff, and how much you perfected your games. Today, people release buggy games like crazy. People ship AAA companies ship $60 games that don't work. You have to go update them for them to be able to work. So that's kind of one of the bigger differences between now and the 90s and game development. Okay, so place a switch. Let's do this a simple way at first. If see place switches. So if the gate type K tile gate 2, if this is a gate 2, then we're going to need to place a gate 2 switch. And let's just do it right there in the total middle of the screen. Make it really obvious where it is and all that. So width shift it down 1, height shift it down 1, K tile gate 2 switch there. So now we should have a switch in the middle of the screen. Back to the 90s? No, trust me, we don't want to go back to the 90s. I don't miss AOL enough to go back to the 90s. Yeah, look at this. Okay, we have the switch now. It's a red wild cinder block. So now we just need the behavior for it to work. And in fact, we need a behavior for this thing working so that we can only hit it with the top hat. Whoops. So hitting, like, you know, that would work. This thing with the top hat, and that would open up these tiles over here. And then, secondly, we need to put this switch on the other side over there. Rocket Bunny would be -4. Right, let's keep on with the behavior then. I'll do behavior first, and then later I'll place the switch where it's exactly supposed to go. Yeah, the hardcore style. Oh, you're born in 2003? Yeah, so wouldn't that make you -4 in 1999? You're but a twinkle. Okay. I've already got some code written. I already got some code written for toggleable switches somewhere. There's like a computer switch thing. It's okay though. Bill Gates has got you covered. Hey, don't worry, man. Math's hard for me, and I'm 3 times your age. Toggleable switches. Where? There's like a computer switch thing or item. Oh, item container. Yeah, there's like an item container switch. There's this freaking switch type. Yo, what's up, J2? Welcome to the stream, man. I'm working on this. These are switch types. These are switches that you can only hit with the top hat. So basically, I'm working on gates still, and this is a gate type where this is the gate over here. Some tiles that you can't pass. can't even bomb them. But you can throw your top hat over them and hit like a switch on the other side. So this little red pillar here is some mock-up art for the switch. And the red pillar is supposed to be on the other side of these walls. But for now, I just put it in the middle of the screen. So basically, you'll be able to throw your top hat, hit the switch, and down comes the wall. You can get across the gate. Can't see them? Oh, you can't see these? These tiles right here? I forgot about the chat window. I totally forgot about that. So this whole time, maybe should I make it so the stream automatically turns off the chat when it runs the game? I bet you I could play with that. Play with the settings in Game Show and like make it so it turns off the chat, but only when I'm running the game. Yeah, I'll play with that next time. Damn, I'm sorry, you guys. This whole time I've been talking about these tiles here. You can't even see them. But oh well, I hope you get the gist. Or just make it half as tall. There we go. Let's do that for now. Okay. All right, cool. Yeah, it does kind of try this. So what do you guys prefer? Do you like the way I used to do it with like where I had a chat window always open and I would switch back and forth between them? Or do you like this new way where I've got the chat open all the time and I got a separate iPad open with the chat? How do I get these to sync up? We just need a BC Warrior counter. Okay, so two votes for the old way, huh? All right, two votes for the old way. How do I get this? This thing does not want to move. Right, it is only used for YouTube, huh? Good point. Okay, well, I'm just going to leave it like that for now. I'm not sure how to get that to work. Oh! Oh yeah, so it was K filter switch. Item flag, vanquish, activate. Oh, right, item flag. Toggleable. That's what we want. We want an entity with filter switch type, and it has an item component with flag toggleable. Whoa, look at that. Nice. It's been a minute. Nine in a row. Nice. Not too shabby. All right, so in the data for the top hat switch, we need an item component and we need a collision component category switch. And we need to put like an item component and flags toggleable. Toggleable, I don't know. And we need one more thing at the end of this. We need some words for item flags, move flags, item flags. Oh, you rebel. Oh, good ideas. Flags. Which one are we looking at now? Move flags? Yeah. Kind of need here. We'll copy this one. We want some item flags. Item flags for... let's look at all the flags we might have for items. Nice. Another thing, I want to see if item flag toggleable. Yeah, that's not even used. So we need to create some kind of special code for toggleable item switches. Man, when I started today's stream, I thought this was going to be way easy, but I didn't realize how detailed this is. But anyways, so okay, we can parse flags this way. Locked. Melee. Activate. Collision activate. Am I the only person that thinks reading books is boring? No, it's standard programmer's mindset. Boogie. Vanquish activate, that's where you would kill it or whatever. Oh, another thing we need in here is actually gate types. I think that's all for now. Let's do a gate type words. Yeah. Oh, that was for the I thought it'd be easy. Oh, this changes everything. All right, we got those flags ready. We need one more thing to components now. We need item component needs to be able to be created from data. So item component. Item component, const file tree, ref data, using default constructor. And then reading it from the data. Yeah, me too. It's Boogie is ice cream truck? Yeah, what's with that? There should be no ice cream truck if it's dark and freezing out. Oh man, our neighborhood has the worst. The ice cream truck sound totally bugs me. I gotta admit, that's one of my pet peeves, is hearing the ice cream truck. And we have the most annoying ice cream truck driver guy. Because I don't know, maybe it's just an annoying place because you could hear it for miles. Run away! So now we can parse the item type equals kid parse flags. They are. Data. Get child. I guess that would just be called type. And the words. Okay, item flags, K item. Oh, this is a gear component thing. Type equals gear component. Don't they? Gear component get item type. There it is. Get item type based on a key. And the key is data get child type. There. Okay. Flags. Oops. This is dot getster. Yeah. I'm glad we're all in agreement on this ice cream truck guy. What's with this guy? Flags, and this is words, words K. Item flags, K. Yeah, K item flags. Right, cool. We got two things parsed. Next thing, price. I guess that could be parsed. There we go. It's the eighth wonder world. Yeah, why does it always sound like it's broken? Yes. And last thing. To hook this up so that an item component can be loaded from data like this. Is to put it into the creation method. Create entity. We'll read the item from the overall data for this entity. And then we, if the entity is alive, I guess an item component doesn't necessarily need to be alive. So if item is not null, we're going to add an item component given the item data. Set a breakpoint there, and we should get this to be hit because we have a one entity with one of those. This planet's called Exera, Ekzerra. Exera. For now, it's called Exera. It's meant to be in, it's right here in our same galaxy, the Milky Way galaxy. It's in the Bellatrix star system, which is part of the Orion arm, which is the same arm that we're on Earth. But it's, you know, it's far away, but still in our relatively close neighborhood of our galaxy. And it's 10,000 years ago. As we would count it. Roughly. Okay, good. Oh, we hit the breakpoint. Great. Let's see what happens when we create this item component. The data we got passed in should just be, it's got one child. Good, we got flags toggleable. So the item type should be, come out to be nothing. Item type none, great. And then we parse the flags. Let's see what happens when we step into this parse flags method. Cool. So we got the string toggleable, words. This last one should be, wait, where's toggleable? There it is, toggleable. Return from this and we should have flags of 16. Yeah, nice. And price should be 0. Good. All right, cool. We can load items from data. That was easy. I love easy stuff. Nice, right on. Cool, dude. I'm glad you're making that. Yeah, nice. Okay, so at this point, we've got an item component added to this entity. But that doesn't do us any good until we're actually using it. And I do believe I'm about done with my time here. We got dinner I can hear it cooking in another room. So this is a good enough place to end it for today anyways. So so that's pretty much it for today's stream. What I'm gonna work on tonight after the stream is to, you know, finish this up. Really, I just gotta get this so the switch can be hit with the top hat and only with the top hat. So there's no way to toggle it or whatever unless you're hitting it with the top hat. And then also to place the switch on the other side of these rocks. And then the last thing I'll do will be to draw the pixel art. So these are gonna be some kind of tiles which can go up or down. I'm not exactly sure what they'll be. And this will be some kind of switch that can just be hit with the top hat. So. Nice, right on. That's a really good royalty you're giving me. Thanks, man. Okay, yeah. So that's it for today's stream. Thanks, you guys. Thanks for watching. Hope you all have a great night. And yeah, we'll catch you next time. Be back tomorrow at Wizard 30. And anybody that just joined the stream, his game's called Songbringer. It's coming out 2016. And you can pre-order it now and get your name in the credits if you want. So that's it for today's stream. See you guys.